Hello, and welcome to the Volvo Environment Prize event 2023. Can a fruit save the largest rainforests of the world? Is the theory about tragedy of the commons just a myth? Well, these are two of the many questions that we will be discussing today. When trying to talk about preserving biodiversity, we very often talk about policies, regulations, but today we will be talking about the people actually living in one of the most biodiverse areas of the world, Amazonia. This is the area of the world where our laureate has been making his research for the last 30 years with some amazing results, and you will soon get to meet with him. The Volvo Environment Prize is celebrating 34 years. It's an environmental science award, very well known within scientific and academic circles around the world, but maybe not so much to everyone else. Let's start by taking a look what it actually is.
The Volvo Environment Prize Foundation is rewarding Pathbreaking Science. For over 30 years, this award has gone to people dedicated to the understanding of our environment: researchers, scientists, professors. From all over the globe, across countless fields of research, from biodiversity to technology, from the cryosphere to the atmosphere, awarding those who pursue the most important knowledge of all: how to make a lasting world. How we tackle the enormous sustainability challenges ahead must be guided by science. That is the reason for the Volvo Environment Prize's existence. The prize doesn't exist just to tell the scientists, "Good job." It's also here to tell everyone else to listen and to act.
Martin Lundstedt, President and CEO of Volvo Group. Very welcome.
Thank you.
Today you're here in your capacity as chair of the Volvo Environment Prize Foundation, right?
Yeah. It's great to be here, Niclas.
Good. Martin, sometimes we hear that the foundation rewards science far from our own business at Volvo Group, be it trucks or buses or construction equipment. What do you say about that?
No, I mean, first and foremost, it was never the intention to be very specific and sectorial into our businesses, rather that to draw attention to research into the field of environmental challenges, about climate change, about biodiversity, and also to really pinpoint that this is a true ecosystem and many different links, and you cannot narrow it down to a specific sector. At Volvo, we believe in science. We believe in the power of science to really get the facts behind the scenes and thereby also build knowledge. By building knowledge, we can act. We know and we understand, and we are working in this society that we need well-functioning, we need ecosystems that can provide fresh water, clean air. We need our best and most brilliant minds to achieve that, and not at least in the field of science. That is why we at the Volvo Group, once upon a time put up the foundation. Run, and that is very, very important, by independent scientists. Both when it comes to the scientific committee, but also the jury. To actually funnel down and get to the award winner. Really to award pathbreaking new science that can support also a better world for tomorrow. In a way, I take my hat off also for the committee and the jury, but also for my predecessors that had the courage back in the days, 34 years ago, to put up the foundation. That was not often on the agenda maybe during that days in the corporate sectors, and we are very proud of that legacy, and we will continue to make sure that we are doing that also in the future. When we look at our laureates over the years, they have done a fantastic job.
Great. In the corporate world, sometimes companies are being accused of greenwashing, talking nicely about sustainability, but perhaps not doing that much. Is that something that concerns you?
No, but I think it's first and foremost, it's always good to have the discussion going, because at the end of the day, I mean, we need transparency and we need to act for real. So I think there are elements in society of greenwashing, not only in the corporate sectors, but overall. And that is not the solution for coming generations. I mean, we need to make this happen for real, right? And when I look at Volvo specifically, just to give some metrics, I mean, we are investing every year many, many billions of euros in research and development. And I'm proud to say that today the absolute majority of that is pointing towards decarbonization, but also a lot of concern about circularity, biodiversity, and how everything is linked. And also our customers, I mean, the pathway to zero, big transition going on. We see that the equipment is coming in now, and that not only for us, but also for the industry at large. So this is a huge transformation, right? But it's also important to understand that we must move now from a society that we know it, and that is from a brown, fossil-based platform up to a green, renewable platform. And that is a coordinated effort. You cannot do it alone. And what we see now, if I take our industry as an example, I mean, the enabling conditions to make this happen, infra, charging, green energy, green supply chains, our equipment must be coordinated to really make sure that it's taking up for real and we need to accelerate. And this requires, of course, cooperation. We often talk about that, but it's more important than ever. Governments, regulators, customers, upstream supply chain partners, academia not at least, that can, you know, poke us and tell us what to do. And I mean, to build on also the science to create then tangible innovations. And we need to accelerate.
Yeah, great. You often talk about innovation and people. And this year's laureate is an anthropologist with a different background, actually, than most previous laureates to the Volvo Environment Prize, who has usually been chemists or biologists or based in natural sciences. Are we sometimes missing out on the so-called people perspective in this?
No, let's put it like this, and that's the reason also why I love, I mean, the decision of the jury. I mean, we are always curious, I mean, who will it be and why will it be and what is the reasoning, etc. But I mean, if we think about change, and this is a huge societal change, but I can think, I can refer to my role as president of the Volvo Group, and when we are doing changes and we are into a big transformation, you can have great technology, you can have great innovations, you can have great network, industrial systems, footprints, supply chain partners, but if you don't have the people perspective, the human-centric perspective of why is this good for different stakeholders, you will never succeed. Because at the end of the day, it's made by people for people in order to build a stronger and better society. And the leadership when it comes to transformation, and not at least this huge undertaking that we have now, boils down to people. And it's boiled down not only to a green transformation, but to a fair transformation. And one of the challenges we have in the world today is, of course, that if we are leaving people or societies behind, we are also creating foundations for dark forces, such as populism or other movements. And we need to really take care about that, because otherwise it will not be sustainable for real.
Thank you very much, Martin, for those words. We will see more of you soon when it's time for the award ceremony.
Looking forward.
Yeah. Now, let's find out more about our laureate this year. We sent science journalist Claes Sjöberg and filmmaker Tore Marklund to look at the research of Eduardo Brondizio.
Everybody's heard about the Amazon, about the ongoing clear-cutting and rainforest burn-down to be replaced by cattle ranches. But there's a lot going on in order to create a more sustainable Amazonia. And this year's laureate has spent decades of research trying to find out how humans here can create a good life with good economic development without destroying the biodiversity of this, the world's largest rainforest.
You cannot deal with sustainability in the Amazon if you do not confront the urban reality of the region.
The Amazonia actually has this deep history where people from the region have developed many different ways of managing the environment, of producing with the forest without destructing it.
Most people know that the world's largest rainforest is in Amazonia, but the region can also be described as an urbanized jungle with over 30 million inhabitants, and most of them live in cities.
The fast expansion, which is due to migration from surrounding rural areas elsewhere in Brazil, has put a lot of pressure on cities that do not have the resources to provide the sanitation. This is a reality for a lot of urban areas in the Amazon, and we need to remember that 80% of the Amazonian population are living in urban areas, and a good number of them live in conditions precarious like this.
We tend to think of the Amazon as pristine areas of rainforest, inhabited only by small groups of indigenous people. But this is a myth.
Amazonia has been part of the global history of economic trade and resource trade for over 400 years, and that history is still here.
Man has affected nature in Amazonia for centuries. For example, during the massive economic boom from rubber production in the 1800s. The economic growth created large Amazonian cities like Belém and Manaus. Essential crops in the global agricultural economy, such as cocoa, cassava, and peanuts, also derive from the domestication of rainforest crops.
When we talk about the Amazon today, we usually tend to think about the last few decades when deforestation, right, and the problems of deforestation came to bear. But there are lots of examples in the Amazon where we see a productive interface between governing territories by the people and for the people who live there, producing in reconciliation with the forest and the rivers, and generate the resources in a more sustainable way.
One such system today is the production of açaí, a popular fruit from a palm tree. Açaí is in demand not only in Brazil, but is exported worldwide. And it all started here.
We are here at the açaí market in Belém, perhaps one of the most emblematic places in the Amazon. Açaí has gained such a momentum because it offers for the Amazon a way forward where food production, economic inclusion, and biodiversity conservation can come game to hand.
Açaí is often produced locally in communities along the Amazon River using agroforestry.
Agroforestry, which is a practice that you find around the globe, is the combination of tree crops, annual crops, and sometimes animal and fishing production as well.
Cofruta is a cooperative. It's a good example of a producers-led cooperative. For 22 years, they have progressively developed a portfolio of fruit pulps, oils, and butters that are extracted from native species or planted species from the Amazonian forest. So it's an effort that tries to bring value aggregation closer to the producers and to be done by the producers. They're bringing tax revenues, they're bringing jobs, and at the same time, they have a major contribution to protecting the environment.
For over 30 years, Eduardo Mendicio has documented and analyzed the development and environmental challenges of the Amazon. But his base is as an anthropology professor at Indiana University. The academic who has perhaps most marked Indiana University is Eleanor Ostrom, the first woman to receive the Memorial Nobel Prize in Economics in 2009. Eleanor Ostrom challenged the conventional view of the so-called tragedy of the commons.
What Eleanor Ostrom and her colleagues did was they showed us that people can be wise stewards managers of resources in ways that are often more effective than governments or government agencies and even private corporations.
An example of how this works in practice is in Amazonia, with the largest scaled fish in the world.
And it's one of the emblematic fish of the Amazon, historically considered one of the most important fishes. Arapaima was almost depleted by the end of the 1990s. But in 20 years, the implementation of community-based management of fisheries led to the recovery of the Arapaima population.
Eduardo Brandizio was one of the co-chairs of the Global Assessment Report on Biodiversity and Ecosystem Services. The scientists behind the report called on countries to begin focusing on restoring habitats, growing food on less land, and stopping illegal logging and fishing. Today, climate security and biodiversity investments are discussed at the highest levels, and the Amazon region plays a key role.
I see action everywhere. That doesn't mean that that's the only solution, that there's a panacea there, but it means that there are seeds and there are great foundations upon which to build a more sustainable and inclusive economy that reverts the deforestation equation.
This was the first part of the film. You will soon get to know our laureate this year a little bit better in the second part of the film. But now, I would like to introduce to you a highly popular Swedish artist, Christine Amparo, who moves seamlessly between jazz, hip-hop, and blues. You could see the Amazon River featured in the film we just saw. Christine, who was born in Cali, Colombia, has written the song and lyrics of Follow the River.
We've been traveling very far to get along with myself. Take the challenge, raise the bar, and share this heartbeat of mine. Why and where your path may lead, we need to find it. Cross, I'll make you see, I will unwind it. 'Cause when we come together in our hearts, oh, love will make us all reach for the stars. Follow the river. Can you hear me now? We have a long way to go. Need to make it through somehow for our love to grow. Why and where your path may lead, we need to find it. Side with our humanity, no need to hide it. 'Cause when we come together in our hearts, oh, love will make us all reach for the stars. Follow the river.
Thank you, Christine Amparo. The Volvo Environment Prize jury chair, Will Steffen, passed away earlier this year. We at the Foundation miss him very much. During his many years as chair of the jury, he highlighted the leading environmental research in the world. We asked Johan Rockström, an internationally recognized scientist in areas of sustainability, to tell us more about the scientific legacy of Will Steffen.
Will Steffen was a remarkable scientist. I've never come across any scientist who has such a full comprehensive understanding of the entire planet and its functions and what it means for humanity to have a stable planet. I remember when he, the first time, led the work on publishing what became known as the Great Acceleration in 2006, when he was heading the International Geosphere Biosphere Program, IGBP. It was a breakthrough. Actually, I would argue that is the most important piece of scientific evidence that brought us to the conclusion that we have entered a whole new geological epoch, the Anthropocene. So despite the fact that there's been so many scholars working on the evidence behind the Anthropocene, I always refer to Will Steffen as the father behind the Anthropocene. He was the first scientist to state that we're starting to hit the ceiling of hardwired biophysical processes that regulates the functioning and the stability of the whole planet. Together with Will Steffen, the whole planetary boundary science theory was born. If it hadn't been for him, it would have been very difficult to come to the point when we had the framework. One of the breakthroughs here, for example, is that it was together with Will that I was able to walk through all the paleoclimatic data showing that the Holocene is our desired state of the planet and the only planetary state that we know for certain can support the world as we know it. This was a statement that came about in so many discussions that we had in a core group, thanks to the insights of Will Steffen. Will was also a courageous scientist. He was a scientist that, based on all the evidence and his understanding of the biosphere and the cryosphere and the climate systems and oceans and the whole Earth system, came to the conclusion that we needed to really start exploring risks of pushing the planet into a completely new trajectory that would be unstoppable. The hothouse Earth trajectory, which he led and became the first author of. So when you think of the big breakthroughs on Earth system science over the last 20 years, you always see a footprint of Professor Will Steffen.
Thank you very much, Johan Rockström. I now turn to Kalle, our chair of the scientific committee. What are your reflections now when the prize is actually 34 years old?
First of all, I would just like to echo what Johan said about Will. Such an amazing person, fantastic human being, and a really, really good scientist who has paved the way and really made a big imprint that will last forever, I would say, in the way we look at our relation to the planet. But we are also happy to have now Professor Mary Schools as the new chair of the jury, and that has meant a lot for the continuation of the quality of the work we're doing in the jury and the scientific committee. 34 years now, so that's amazing to look back at what has been going on. And if you really think about it, these issues are now on the table all over the place, and really, really profoundly important if we're going to talk about a future civilization that we live in prosperity and peace and with dignity. So obviously, over these years, we have had an enormous amount of good laureates, and many of them has definitely contributed to the big transformation or transition that we are in right now, I would say. So if we look back at all these years, we have had almost around 52 laureates, because sometimes there have been more than one in 1 year. And let's hear what some of them have to say about progress.
Yeah.
CO2 lifetime is 100 years, 1,000 years. But methane, ozone, their lifetime was around 10 years. Black carbon is about 10 days. So if you put diesel filters, that black carbon in the air is gone in 2 weeks. So its climate effect is gone.
What I've been trying to do is to bring those concerns, the protection of those other critters and the processes that are driving that system which he enjoys, as part of our daily reasoning. To understand the place of nature in our lives, it's not simply amenities, it's essential.
Whatever we do, we're generating carbon dioxide. The Earth has a budget, just like anything else. And if we add greenhouse gases to the atmosphere, it's going to keep more heat into the planet, be less escaping to space, and the planet has no choice but to warm up. That's basic physics, and there's no way to beat basic physics.
It's critical that we bring in climate stability, flood control, water purification, and these basic benefits that we pay for one way or another, either through nature or through trying to build substitutes, which we don't do very successfully and we can't do on the scale required. If we don't put a price tag on nature, we are effectively saying nature is worth nothing.
There is less and less fish to catch. If we make the high sea the fish bank of the world, where the fish can hide and grow, that will make the biodiversity improve, that will make the economics improve. Now people are saying, hey, maybe this is a wise thing. We can do it, we can sustain the ocean.
I now welcome Sybille van der Hove, a member of the prize jury. Sybille, tell me, in our laureate's research, what was it specifically that grabbed the attention of the jury?
Yeah, you know, when we select a laureate as a jury, we have a set of criteria. Of course, scientific excellence is an obvious one, but we have also, we go beyond that criteria and we have other criteria. Yeah. One of them is we look at how, if the nominee has opened new areas, new approaches to research. That's a very important criteria. And also because this is about environmental science, sustainability science, we also look at impact. We look at whether the possible laureate has influenced policy and practice, has been involved in policy fora and so on. And of course, this involvement should have led to real world improvements. So that's the kind of criteria we use. And Eduardo, of course, ticks a lot of these boxes. We were specifically attracted by his capacity to really develop and also foster transdisciplinary research, starting from the social sciences, starting from anthropology, but going way beyond to develop a systemic understanding of things, bringing together different sciences at different levels, on different scales, temporal scales, spatial scales. And with that, his works really enriches our understanding of the role of place, the role of people, the role of local knowledge, and also indigenous communities, and how this can help us develop our relationship with the ecosystem and in sustainability transformation.
Great. Thank you, Sybille. Now it's time for the jury citation.
Yes, I will read only part of the citation. So Professor Eduardo Brandizio is walking the bridges between social, political, and biophysical sciences to deepen our understanding of complex landscape systems. He is a world leader in complex systems thinking, which is embedded in an ethnographic approach. Eduardo has made extensive contribution to policy development through the engagement with the Millennium Ecosystem Assessment and the Intergovernmental Science Policy Panel on Biodiversity and Ecosystem Service, also called IPES.
Thank you, Sybille. And now it's time to get to know Eduardo just a little bit more in part two of the film.
I love soccer.
He loves soccer and football. He really understands the role of creativity.
Soccer is a situation where you are an individual
You play your skills, you have your creativity, you have your aims and goals, but you're also part of a team.
He is a firm believer in collaborating with people from across the university.
He helps people. He likes to help people.
He's a really kind person. He's super friendly.
I don't think I've ever seen Eduardo angry. I've seen him frustrated.
He's a very good baker. He's doing bread, very good bread.
I don't know any student he has that doesn't love working with him.
He respects, I think, his students as peers.
I was born in a city called São José dos Campos. We came from the rural areas and from a small town to a city that was growing fast. And my mom in particular, but also my dad, they would always comment and help us to read that changing landscape. You know, the forest is disappearing, and they were always super concerned with the water. Water is a sacred thing that we have to protect. So that interpretation of the landscape, you know, really touched me very deeply. And my mother-in-law also had influence on myself, because before I met my wife, I met my mother-in-law as a journalist. And she wrote this book, the 1980s, called The Genocide of the Caiçaras. These are the fisher communities along the coast of São Paulo in that region. That book made a huge impact on my life, and I decided to put my skills to understand the impact of that transformation. Sustainability challenges are about people.
What I really most admire is that he's always the one to say, if you're going to tackle a climate problem, you have to have social scientists at the table.
I think it helps create a bridge between local and indigenous knowledge systems and global scale problems.
Participant observation, learning by living and experience together, it gives a very deep perspective. One of the main motivations that I have in doing research is not only the questions that drive me, but the opportunities to work with colleagues, to work collaboratively. This is what I value most in research. But that collaboration has another aspect that has shaped my life and my career, which is to work with one particular collaborator, my wife, and also my daughters. So we form a team that's very special. As a scientist, we need to look at the future and see some hope and contribute with information, with knowledge, with discussions, with data that will contribute towards a different future, a more positive future.
And now, let's move to a panel discussion on this topic. The challenge of preserving biodiversity and having economic growth and equity. This is a session with the 2023-year-old laureate, Professor Eduardo Brondizio. Also in the studio with us here, we have Marie Stenseke, Professor, School of Business, Economics and Law here in Gothenburg. On link from Bonn in Germany, we have Dr. Anne Larigaudry, who is Executive Secretary at IPES, the Intergovernmental Platform on Biodiversity and Ecosystem Services. And on link from Florence in Italy, we have Thomas Sterner, Professor in Environmental Economics, Gothenburg University, but currently at Florence School of Regulation, European Union Institute. Welcome, all of you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
I want to start by asking you, Edward, about the acai fruit we saw in the film. It's obviously so that acai cultivation has boosted local economies, but some environmentalists claim expansion of the acai palms could also cause a loss of biodiversity. What is your answer to that?
Thank you for that question, Nicholas. This is a really important question, and it is because there is no panacea.
There's no panacea for solving the food problem in the Amazon, for solving environmental problems in the Amazon, or you know, any of those questions. And açaí cannot be seen as a panacea. Yeah. What we have seen in the film is the kind of açaí production that is small and mid-scale. And you see in all occasions that is a mix of agroforestry and the forests. So at that scale, it has maintained biodiversity. It has allowed people to have more income. It has provided employment to hundreds of thousands of people in the region. Mm-hmm. The expansion of açaí, on the other hand, has also led to homogenization and to monocropping, right? Creating some of the same problems that we see with other crops. Mm-hmm. In some cases, however, açaí is being used for restoration of pastures as well.
Okay.
So there is no panacea, but açaí offers a way in which you can reconcile local knowledge, food production, employment, and also development for municipalities. It shows one way that we can pursue the challenge that we have today in the Amazon.
Mm-hmm. And in the film, you highlighted the social issues for the people in Amazonia.
Yeah.
Are we generally overthinking about protecting nature and the forest and forgetting about the social dimensions?
Both dimensions are important, Nicholas, right? Sometimes and often we tend to pay attention to the environmental concerns that we have, particularly when we think about a region like the Amazon, and it's important to the globe. But in doing so, we may hide or forget about the scale of social problems that are at the shadows of the forest and the shadows of the city. So we can need to confront those problems, you know, face on, and really bring them forward. Mm-hmm. A lack of attention to the social also hides the solutions and the responses that people have on the ground, right? Many times that are shadowed by the problems that we see.
Mm-hmm.
So the environmental and the social need to come together for us to confront the problems that we have.
Yeah, and to create the jobs. And I mean, you were mentioning the small-scale producers here.
That's right.
Maybe they are not that small after all, or?
Thank you for mentioning that. I think this is one of the biggest misconceptions that we have as a society when we think about small-scale producers, as we think as the Amazon localized. Think about the açaí case. It employs hundreds of thousands of people. It has transformed large landscapes in the Amazon. But more broadly, you know, one of the biggest crises that we have globally is unemployment in rural areas because we disregard the importance of smallholder food production.
Mm.
But think about it. Smallholder farmers, the ones that are small than 2 hectares, provide 35% of the global food supply. Now, if you take into account family farms, we're talking about 70%.
Wow.
Of food production.
Mm-hmm.
If we talk about small-scale fisheries, as we have seen, that employs more than mining, energy, and other sectors together.
Wow.
So they have a scale. We just need to pay attention, to recognize, and to provide support so they can provide a good life for people where they live.
Excellent. Thank you, Eduardo. I now turn to you, Ann. IPBES is sometimes compared with the IPCC. And expectations are that you will have the same role for biodiversity that we see that the IPCC has for driving the global dialogue on the climate change. Can you do that, and is that possible, you think?
Yes, thank you, Niklas. First, I wanted to say how proud IBES is about Eduardo receiving this prize. As mentioned in the film, Eduardo co-chaired the landmark IBES Global Assessment report on biodiversity and ecosystem services that has raised an unprecedented level of awareness on biodiversity. It's been hugely influential, and IBES owes Eduardo a lot. Now to your question. I would say that IBES is already playing the same role as IPCC. So IBES is informing, among others, the work of the Convention on Biological Diversity, which through its decisions requests scientific reports from IBES. So for example, IBES is soon going to embark upon an assessment on biodiversity monitoring. And the idea is to assist governments and others with their efforts to measure biodiversity and to do better in terms of the outcome by better understanding the impacts of the measures they take. So that is one example of how IBIS is playing a role, which is very similar to what IPCC is doing in the context of the Climate Change Convention.
That is great, Anne, and very interesting. And but if I challenge you a little bit, I would still claim that in the general discussions in society, maybe biodiversity is not discussed to the same extent as climate change. Do you think that can change in general, or do you agree with me?
So not fully. I don't fully agree with you there either. And this time it's because I think that biodiversity is discussed, but not under the word biodiversity. I think biodiversity actually is masking many other terms that people are actually discussing on a daily basis. Think about the degradation of ecosystems, the loss of pollinators as a result of pesticides and how that affects production of crops. Think about reduced water quality and as a result of fertilizers. Think about the emerging of diseases, of pandemics, and how we try to understand how that relates to deforestations, to wildlife trades. All of those are real issues that people want to learn more about and that they are really discussing. So yes, biodiversity may not be heard as much as climate, but the biodiversity-related issues, I think, are really very much at the core of what people care about and want to solve.
Oh, thank you very much, Anne, for proving me wrong. I appreciate that. Let's go to you now, Thomas. In the film, we heard about the so-called tragedy of the commons, a situation where shared environmental resources are overused. This is a theory criticized by many. But what is your comment? We have overfishing in many parts of the world and other examples of natural resources being depleted. Isn't at least part of the theory valid?
Well, these problems are real. It's just the name, right? And Elinor Ostrom is the person to turn to when it comes to the commons. And she spent her life trying to straighten up the terminology. And so there is a problem of open access. If you have open access to natural resources, they will tend to be depleted and overused and destroyed. So you need some kind of control of access. This was fundamental for Eleanor. Usually it is the owner who stands for that. And the owner can be a private person. It can be the state. It can also be a collective of fishermen, a collective of farmers. It can be a village. And Eleanor showed in many, many, many articles how well, for sometimes thousands of years, communities have been able to manage resources.
Yeah, thank you. If we think about Amazonia then, Thomas, there is the dilemma that the huge rainforest areas needs to be protected for climate stability, and at the same time the people living there in harsh conditions, as we know, need economic development. As an environmentalist and environmental economist, what is your comment on solving that dilemma?
Yeah, well, it's really the same answer that more or less fragile resources, you need protection. And the original population have been living for a long time in the Amazon. Many of them use nature sustainably in a sensible and measured way. When Amazon gets opened up and you get more and more people coming in from outside, then they can sometimes bring with them very destructive technologies, and the result can be a disaster. That is always the case with open access.
Thank you, Thomas. I now turn to you, Marie. Both you and Eduardo have been working with IPBES, and especially on the major report on biodiversity. And I know that you have prepared a few questions for Eduardo. So please, go ahead.
Thank you very much. I'm very glad to get this opportunity. And my question goes on the same line a bit like Thomas. It was mentioned on the film, the quite rapid migration and by that urbanization and also marginalization of people that was shown in the picture. So my question is a good quality of life possible really for all people now living in the Amazonia? I mean, both the urban and the rural ones, without the deteriorating nature, what are the plausible ways towards sustainability that takes care of both environment and humans that you see, and doing so in a fair and equitable way?
Thank you for this question, Marie. Let me start this way. I think as scientists, it's our responsibility to have hope, right? And to see that it's possible to reconcile our development needs and, you know, protect the nature that we depend so much on. But when it comes for the Amazon is one of the regions that has generated some of the most wealth for the world. And it has always been seen as an El Dorado for outsiders, right? So I think, and have left behind the problems, the deterioration, the poverty, and the violence. We are at a particular time now that this is an important point, which is we have more than ever, you know, we're thinking about the Amazon and it's important for the globe, for the climate, for biodiversity, for water, and for commodities. I think we need to revert that equation. I think we need also to start talking about the Amazon for Amazonians' sake. If we address the problems of the Amazon, if we address the problems of the people in the Amazon, the global contributions will come. So to revert that equation, we need to revert that idea that the region is there to provide to our wealth, right? And that means that the wealth of the region needs to stay and be generated in the region. It needs to include the people of the region. Value aggregation needs to be done closer to producers. And beyond the environmental issues that are there, the Amazon needs a lot of infrastructure, infrastructures that contribute to the life of people. So I think we know the formula. We know that we need to generate resource there. We need to confront the complex problems that we have in the region, the rural, the urban, the indigenous, and we need to put the Amazonian people up front. Right, that will create an Amazonia that is more just and that will benefit the world as a whole.
Thank you very much. And you kind of touched upon my next question, really, is I'm very glad to see you here in November in Gothenburg, though it's maybe not the best season to get here. And we seem to be quite far away from the Amazons. Yeah. But the world is global and interconnected. So my question is, what can we do here, if you could say, in Europe or Western Europe, in this part of the world, to enhance sustainability in the Amazons? How can we enhance what you just said?
That's also an important question. But let me start like this. These problems are complex, like here and there. And I think one important issue is that we face complexity, but we recognize that every single contribution is important at all levels. So complexity cannot paralyze us. So there are different kinds of actions for different sectors in this part of the world or other parts of the world that are important. For instance, you think about markets, and we heard before about responsible value chains, right? And certification and fair trades that gives incentives and support for those who are producing in a sustainable and socially just way. Investments. We are entering a phase of enormous amount of climate investments, of biodiversity investments. Those investments need to have and be tied to social issues, right? So they also have an impact, not only on what benefits the planet as a whole, but, you know, on the people on the ground. And finally, consumers. As consumers, we have a lot of power, and we have a lot of power to empower people who are doing good things on the ground. There are thousands of initiatives in the Amazon. We saw the example of one cooperative by producers who is developing technology, aggregating value right in the region, generating resource, taxes, employment, and supporting production systems that are sustainable. We need to support them as well so they can continue to do what they do.
Thank you very much, Eduardo and Marie, and thank you to the panel. We need to move on in the program now. So thank you for a great discussion. And we now have a message from the president of the Indiana University, Bloomington, USA, Pamela Witten.
Professor Brandizio has been a driving force in multiple research communities, most notably as the director of IU's Center for the Analysis of Social Ecological Landscapes and through his close association with the Ostrom Workshop. These contributions have not only enriched IU's academic landscape, but also advanced our understanding of social and ecological dynamics. His engagement with IU's Center for Latin American and Caribbean Studies further promotes the exchange of ideas and insights. Professor Brandizio exemplifies IU's dedication to innovative, impactful research. His cooperative spirit has not only shaped our academic community, but has also left a profound mark on the Amazon region, highlighting the importance of collective efforts in addressing current social and environmental challenges. Beyond research, Professor Brandizio's commitment to nurturing the next generation of scholars is truly extraordinary. He has facilitated academic exchange programs between IU and Brazilian institutions, fostering the growth of numerous doctoral and graduate students. To date, Brandizio has chaired or served in advisory committees of over 110 graduate students and 11 undergraduate theses, and sponsored over 40 international graduate students and visiting scholars at IU. His legacy of interdisciplinary and collaborative research will continue to inspire countless individuals. Congratulations, Professor Brandizio, on your extraordinary achievements, and thank you for your dedication to advancing knowledge and inspiring future generations.
Thank you, Pamela Witten. We are now approaching the award ceremony. The prize, it is a glass sculpture, a handmade diploma, and 1.5 million Swedish kronor. And with this year, we have, as you have heard before, 52 scientists who have received the Volvo Environment Prize. You met a few of them earlier, so let's have a look at the laureates in recent years, as well as for this year. So it's time for the award ceremony. So Eduardo and Martin, please join me on stage. Over here, Eduardo.
Dear Eduardo, great pleasure to have the opportunity to say a couple of words to you. We have listened to the quotation of and the motivation from the jury. But some personal words about your work. First and foremost, that you have taken and started from a human-centric view is just fantastic, and I think that is an imperative for change that will last. And that you have been able also to connect the global large-scale challenges that we have, but connecting that to local societies and at the end of the day to each individual is, I think, fundamental for sustainable change. And sustainability is about the ecological, but also economical, social, ethical sustainability that must go hand in hand. On a personal note, I've had the chance to live in Brazil. Brazil is a country very close to my heart and a lot of friends. And on that note also, sharing a lot of your views about leadership. Leadership that is decentralized, accountable, and thereby bringing lasting ownership where it belongs. So, from us, also in the Volvo Environment Prize Foundation, it's a great honor to add you to the fantastic list of scientists that has received this prize, and cannot think about anyone that is really worth it more than you have done with your research.
The so. Sun will come out. Tomorrow, bet your bottom dollars that tomorrow there'll be sun. Just thinking about tomorrow takes away that cobweb and the sorrow till there's none. As I stuck in a day that's gray and lonely, I decide that my shame and grin and say, ooh, ooh, the sun will come out tomorrow, so you better hang on till. I'm stuck in a day that's gray and lonely.
So, everyone that has been joining us this afternoon, I hope that you have also found this session as fantastic as we have done here today. We have heard about the importance of science, and I think you have felt it yourself also. And in a world with a lot of challenges and gloomy outlook, I think it's also time to celebrate. And taking the standpoint in the fact that trust is the ultimate human currency. And partnership is the new leadership. And I think this year's laureate has really shown what that means. Science as the base, building knowledge, knowledge building opportunities and solutions. Solutions brought into action will make it happen. Thank you for participating today, and join us in the journey for the future, shaping the world that we want to live in for future generations.
The sun will come out tomorrow, bet your bottom dollar.